I'm your host, Katie Burrell, and this is The Arc of It, brought to you by Arc'teryx Academy.
Our guest today is Sarah Hueniken, one of the most sought-after ACMG guides in Canada. Of course, she has been on first ascent teams, climbing and ice climbing all over the world. And, fun fact, she was the first North American woman to climb grades M11 to M14. But what Sarah does is take what she loves and make it possible for others, effectively amplifying opportunities for other people to get into the mountains. From coaching clinics to private guiding, Sarah expands the access to these wild places. And you'll hear in our conversation that she's almost more interested in the community that is created around mountain life than the mountains themselves. Maybe I'm speaking for her there. You can make your own decision after you listen to the podcast. Here's Sarah.
Let's just start from the beginning. Where are you from? Where are you now? How did this all come to be? Just from a physical standpoint.
Okay, well, I'm from Niagara region in Ontario, and presently I live in Canmore, Alberta. I've been here for 20-something years. Yeah, I live with my partner, Will, and half-time with his two kids, Marie and Rose, who are 14 and 10, and our dog, Freya, who's a recent addition.
Oh, yeah?
Our Mexican mutt from... Yeah, from Mexico. A little mutt from Mexico. Yeah, a life changer.
Oh my God, that's so special. Yeah. I'm a big dog person. We could spend the next hour just talking about dogs.
Okay, let's just do that.
Seriously.
Look at her. She's way cuter.
What is Freya's eating pattern? Yeah. When does she sleep? When does she wake up? What's her nap structure look like? Yeah. What's her favorite toy?
our dogs could have a little interaction.
Yeah, oh my gosh, for sure. My dog is also a rescue. He's from China. He was a street dog in China, and
where in China?
In Ningbo. He was found in a puddle, effectively, the just barking at the guards outside the detention center, and now he lives in Revelstoke and is a mountain biking dog. All 17 pounds of fluff.
Hey, mine's 17 pounds too. They'd be best friends, I bet.
I just feel dogs are, I don't know, they're something else. They're really something else. I think they're so special.
I agree.
So why did you choose Canmore 20 years ago?
I drove out with my best friend at the time after university. And yeah, once the mountains kind of came into the horizon and we saw them, we both were like, it was an emotional reaction, I'd say.
Right.
It just... realized there was so much potential out here, so much to explore, so much to see, do, like the people. It just, got me super psyched, I guess.
And was growing up, mountaineering, climbing, skiing a big part of your life, or is that something you discovered after college?
Yeah, that was something I just, when I was young, my uncle took me on a canoe trip. Mm-hmm. So that was eye opening. And then when I was 15, I took an Outward Bound course in Northern Ontario for a month. And so I recognized I loved the outdoors and challenge and the simplicity of it. But I didn't really start climbing till university. And I had never heard of a mountain guide or any of that. So when I came out and I realized how big of a community there was out here specifically for that, it kind of made me want to focus all my attention on it.
Yeah, it's so intoxicating. Hey, I remember when I moved to Revelstoke right after college and I was like, wait, this is a whole career. This is a lifestyle. This is a whole thing. I hadn't really put that together before. I thought you had to be a doctor or a lawyer. That was kind of the options in my head.
When I'd go home and my aunts and uncles would still, ask my parents, oh, how's that camp counseling job or whatever,
Right.
Like a camp counselor, even though I invested, a decade into a career as a guide, just wasn't really known in Ontario. I don't know if it is now, but
different
not in my
culture
family.
For sure. So, what was the process for you in terms of becoming, ACMG and where you're positioned now? I know it's hard to brag about yourself, but please share.
When I first came out, I was just working for Outward Bound and Knowles, and I wasn't ready to do my assistant rock. So I kind of took a break and trained and then came back, did my assistant rock. And at that point I realized, wow, this is a long process and one I want to keep learning with and pursue. And so the next 6 years I invested into becoming an alpine guide. And it was always one of those things, like, I can't wait to be able to like sit in a plane, you know, with that person you don't know. And they ask you, what do you do? And you're like, I'm an ACMG alpine guide. But you know what? Yeah. Then it actually comes into fruition and you don't really tell anyone. You're kind of like, oh, that, you know, now I'm ready to do something different. No, I still love it. And now I work, you know, teaching other guides, like doing the trainings and the exams for the rock program and some of the alpine program.
Okay. When did that transition happen?
Like 7 years ago, maybe.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, and what was the work? Sorry, what was your work like previously to that?
Just guiding for myself.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, which I still do a fair amount of.
Yeah. And people are coming to Canmore from all over the world and they're looking for someone to give them an experience and they go on the internet, Google guides, and boom. And then you're creating like full experiences for them, or are you just primarily doing?
No, I mean, I did a lot of courses. I used to really focus on women specific courses, in the alpine, rock climbing, ice climbing. And then, you know, the other thing is just private guiding, not just private guiding. So people come with something they want to do and you try to make it a reality as best as you can. Have a good experience out there climbing something longer, bigger, something that they wouldn't be able to do maybe on their own, or they're
right.
Don't have enough information to do on their own. Yeah. So good combination of teaching and guiding.
And then you also have your, like, as an athlete, pursuits kind of adjacent to that. And what is that? What's that look like? I'm sure there's a bit of a tension between being an athlete and a guide.
Especially the older I get, because I don't have the same energy I used to have. Be like, oh, yeah, I'll just guide all day and then I'll go climbing after work and I'll still push myself. And yeah, that's getting harder to do, I would say. But the two are so different in my mind. Mm-hmm. Like when I'm guiding, I'm there for someone else's day and experience, make it as good as I can. And I get the benefit of being outside and being active and getting to climb and spend time with someone, but it's about their day. So then the athlete side is about, still satiating my own curiosity of what is possible for me to do in climbing. Or so they're very different and they're hard to balance sometimes, but I think they still work well together.
Have your curiosities shifted over time? Or changed over time in terms of what was really kind of like turning you on about your own climbing?
Yeah, they've shifted. They've evolved. I'd say curiosity is still curiosity. It's still like the wondering of, if you can see something through, whether it's difficult because it's difficult physically or it's difficult because it's difficult mentally, or the logistics are difficult or unknown. So I guess it's the unknown of things and kind of the process of figuring it out that is intriguing.
For sure. Yeah. I mean, I think the process is half the joy some of the times, and we forget that, you know, you get to
should be.
I don't have any first ascents under my bios anywhere, but I mean, maybe you can speak to this, but the process of it, I feel, is it's 99% of it. There's the 1% is standing on the top. You know what I mean? It's like you have to love the entire process and be attracted to the entire process.
Definitely. Yeah. I don't know how to add to that, but you said it well.
Well, I can just speak to it from personal experience. I'm like, you know, if it was a stand-up show or if it was a, you know, whatever, you get the applause at the end, it feels good for like, you know, that moment. And then you leave the stage and you're like, I messed this joke up or I screwed up this tagline. Like, I got to go back and start again and try again and rewrite this and rework that. And it's like, you have to love that stuff more than you have to love the applause, right? Because otherwise,
Yeah. I mean, you dream of that like culminating moment for sure. That's what kind of drives you.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. If you're not enjoying that process, that moment in the end is super fleeting. And right away, you're thinking of the next thing to do. So it's just human nature. You better enjoy the whole process. Yeah. You're missing out on life.
And meditate more, apparently. That's what all the self-help books keep telling me, but haven't gotten there yet.
Me neither.
Oh my God, if one more person tells me to meditate, I'm like, you know what? I just don't think this is going to be a thing that I do in my life. I'm sorry. I'm not a meditator. Like, I'm going to just be more anxious than you. I'm sorry. Like, this is just how I'm going to exist.
You know, I started to go to acupuncture.
Oh.
And that's a new thing for me. But that's quite meditative because you're actually forced to lie there for like 15 minutes with these needles in you.
Yeah.
And there's nothing you can do. So yeah,
the forced meditation. That's smart. What were you, if you don't mind me asking, were you having pain or inflammation or what was the acupuncture for?
I've been having a lot of neck issues. So just compressed discs in my neck that are pinching my nerves and my arms. So this hasn't been the best spring summer for climbing for me, but until I kind of get that situated.
Yeah, it releases a lot of stuff. The acupuncture, like the energy and the chi moving again and the blood flow, like, again, not super versed in how it works, but I'm like, okay, you know what? I'm not asking questions because this feels good.
Yeah. Just don't go dehydrated.
Yeah.
That totally
hurts. Yes, totally. Yes. So, are you an examiner then as well?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. So you're like scary to people.
Yeah. I'm very scary.
What's your process for examining? Like, oh my God, I just know so many people have gone through the exam and it's like the most stressful. They have coaches, they have performance coaches leading up to it. They're like praying they don't get their period. There's like so much going on. They're just like so stressed. Like, how does it feel to be on the other side of that?
Yeah, no, I go into it just really wishing and hoping people the best. Like, I just want them to do their best because you don't want to see anyone, you know, break or make silly mistakes. You just want everyone to do well because you know that they're going to be a great guide. Like, I really believe that they're all going to be great guides. And so just trying to give them that space and try to not be too intimidating. I don't know how to do that. Like, not wear a bright orange jacket with a badge on it, and sunglasses and writing a book. Like, just, but also sometimes I could be distracting because I'm trying to be all happy and friendly. And then, you know, I don't want to mess up their focus either. So it's a hard balance.
Yeah, for sure. I bet you can just watch it sometimes. I think after you examine that many people, you can sort of start to get a real intuitive read on people. You're like, oh, I'm watching this person fall apart right now and I know that's not who they are and I don't want to say anything.
Yeah, exactly.
It must be hard.
That is hard. Yeah.
So what was the pull to, to teaching and starting these clinics and getting women out, and how did this all come to be?
Yeah.
With your clinics and your courses.
When I was 15, I took that Outward Bound course. I ended up being in an all girls group and, that was not what I was hoping for at all. Like, I thought I was going to meet the boy of my dreams and we'd spend 3 weeks on a canoe trip together. but it ended up being like the best experience for me, really.
Right.
Because everyone had to take every job, you know, everyone had to portage the canoes and make the fire and cook dinner and blah, 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 and work together. And I think that really stuck with me and made me feel like that's the kind of courses I want to be offering women as well, just where there's lots of space to step out front and try and be okay with not being perfect, you know, failing, succeeding, being okay with all of that and that camaraderie, and then having other women to go out with after the course together. That kind of is what drove me to build more women's courses.
That's really powerful. There's so many things I find, like, I'll just naturally defer to a guy in the group if he's available.
Yeah.
But when it is all women, you realize like, oh, I can do this, you know?
Yeah.
I was biking with a group of girls the other day and there was like this kind of rock roll and the guys went over it in the front. And then I was like, oh God, that looks awful. And then the three girls in front of me just boom, 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 did it. And I was like, I just found myself doing it. I'm like, yeah. Oh, like, you know, you see women doing it around you and then you're like, oh, this is within my realm. You know, this is within.
Yeah. It definitely inspires you to see it. Like, I know when I seek out learning a new skill, I try to find a woman to learn from because it will make me feel like it's possible for me in a way that seeing, and I think it's on, I think it's a bit of like my era or whatever. Cause when I talk to the girls who are 10 and 14, they don't feel that way.
Mm.
Like they don't see the separation or the distance between what their boy, like a boy their age can do and what they can do. And I just wonder when we, or when I lost that in life, or if it's a transition that's happening now with the new generation. I don't know, but it's exciting. I just think, I just think there's way more potential for women in sport and in the outdoors. If we just, you know, I don't think it means being competitive. It just means being like allowing ourselves to think we can do things because we see another human doing it. Not just, we don't always need to see another woman doing it before we can do it. I don't know.
Totally. Yeah. It's so interesting. Cause it's like, there's this, you're right. There's a moment where it goes away or it changes or something in your head. I don't know what, if it's a pituitary thing or what's going on, but it's, then there's also the whole culture around like that sort of, we're sort of moving out of it, but it was like maybe 5-10 years ago, there was room for one woman or there was a seat at the table for one. And so you had to be the best and you had to beat out all the other women to get that seat with all the guys. Hmm. So women were becoming inherently more and more competitive with each other, which was sort of not helping our cause in any way. And now it's shifted to like, let's create our own table. Or now there's room for more of us at the table. And if I get a seat at the table, I'm going to bring you to a spot at the table. Like recognizing that it's like, if I do it, then I got to bring another woman along and we all have to kind of help each other get, you know, this kind of get our presence known and be in these different places that we weren't before. So I don't know how long ago it was, but it used to feel different. I used to remember thinking like, oh, if she gets it, then I can't have it. You know?
Yeah. And as a woman, I think naturally we don't really like that competition feeling. You know, we like kind of like a web relationship where we all do work more together and build each other up. So right away, setting up that competition made a lot of people back out from getting involved.
I think you're totally right. Or yeah, I feel you're totally right. I am. I'm very non-competitive. I don't actually like the feeling of it at all.
Yeah.
And I found myself shying away from so many things because I just didn't want to feel that feeling. And I think it's maybe sort of connected to your not good enough feelings a little bit. Or like some trauma, it's probably trauma, but it's like, you know, it just sort of like would light up that part of my brain that was like, oh, like maybe she's better than me or he's better. Like, I can't keep up or I'm not good, you know, and then that competitive. And then next thing you know, it's an anxiety, you know, you're spiraling. So, creating these environments, I just think is so empowering and important. And, I applaud you for it. How is it now? Like, are you running clinics and stuff right now, like post COVID or how?
Yeah, now I've sort of, I'm working as a core community lead for Arc'teryx Alberta. And in that position, I get the amazing opportunity to kind of create new programs for the BIPOC community or LGBTQ or so we've been running a bunch of different kind of like intro to rock days for, just for some, people who don't get the opportunity or haven't had as much opportunity to get outside and experience it. So yeah, it's a great opportunity for me to give back in a different way now. Like I still want to do women's programs and offer that, but I'm seeing a whole lot of other communities that need more attention right now. And That's where I want to put my energy.
Yeah. I mean, all ships rise with the tide.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's incredible. Cause did you took a step back last year from it and sort of you were working in, I know you're working in, grief and recovery and trauma in the mountains and, now you're moving into this space. Like what's been the evolution there? How's that evolution happened?
Yeah, I definitely, you know, I lost a really close friend a couple of years ago, during one of my women's camps. She was in another guided party and, there was an avalanche. And so that definitely changed everything for me. After that, it put everything on the back burner. It was a full on break from life. And it still is a big break from, a lot of the way I look at the mountains, a lot of the way I look at risk, a lot of, how I engage with the mountains and the mountain community. And it's really shifted my focus towards trying to build awareness in different ways and, put my energy towards different communities to give them opportunities in the mountains versus just focusing on what I was doing all the time, what I want to do necessarily, or focusing on my sport for myself. It's, yeah, just changed my whole focus.
I'm really sorry. Prior to this event versus now, can you tell us a little bit about that? I know there's a real culture around mountains and, you know, getting rad and being sick and yada, yada, yada. And I think like people with real experience in them can help shift that. And I would love if you could share with me kind of the mentality change, you know, from pre and post tragedy.
I guess in this situation, there was no trying to be rad or push a risky situation. It was just what felt like another another day of going ice climbing, in the mountains, in what seemed like a safe place to be that day. So what that has kind of opened up my eyes to, which my eyes have always been open to, but I think it's opened up the eyes for everyone, just that the mountains are inherently risky and you can do everything to know as much as you can know and to be as prepared as you can be. And things still aren't in your control. And we have to go into that environment accepting that that is a possibility all the time. And I don't think we do, because it takes away from some of that joy that we're looking for, right? We can't live in perpetual fear of everything all the time. That wouldn't make the mountains a very fun place to be. But we do have to accept that there are things that we don't control. And yeah, try to learn as much as we can from that. I don't know. I'm still in the process of figuring it all out myself, be honest. And so because I don't still have an answer, I am really, you know, I took on the position of ice climbing ambassador for Avalanche Canada to try to keep building knowledge and information throughout the winter when people go ice climbing to post conditions reports on avalanches. And just we don't know enough. Like, we are
right.
It's not like skiing where you're fully in the environment, you're underneath something and you have limited knowledge and information. I think we can still try to learn more about that. So that's one place I'm taking it. And the other place I'm taking it is just, it's really hard. And I think most mountain users at a certain age will have lost someone to the mountains or in the mountains while they've been recreating or pursuing their passion. And I think it's hard to go back out there and find that joy that you had before, mm-hmm. knowing how devastating it can also be. But I think I'm just trying to build more conversation around that and building this grief group. The Mountain Muskox is part of that. Just have people talk more about both sides. Like, yeah, we get these amazing rewards. We get great relationships. We get beauty, challenge, quiet. We get all these things, but we can also get the worst day of our life out there. And how do we deal with that? How do we talk about it? How do we deal with it together? So when it happens, we don't feel separated from all those other people that are still, you know, shredding the gnar. And
yeah,
just to have a more well-rounded community around the realities of the mountains.
Totally. Yeah, I mean, that really is hitting me hard. Like you hear these great stories, like, how's your day? Oh, so great. This, that. And like, on the complete other side of that spectrum, it's like, how's your day? It's like, well, we lost someone in our group today. Like, or this, yeah. You know, an injury happened that required a heli evac. Or, you know what I mean? It's so spread. Like the things that can happen out there. Like, and I think what you're saying about bringing those closer to each other, in a sense, we got really lucky out there today. Mm-hmm. We had a really beautiful day. The conditions were really safe. No one was hurt. Like it's kind of a shift in language almost. And it's a shift in priorities as well.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think we realize as a guide, I've always been hypervigilant. I'm always looking around at all the possible things that can go wrong all day. Mm-hmm. It's exhausting for sure. But I don't think on average, we go back at the end of the day and recognize how many close calls we had, right? Or how many that foothold could have broke, or that, that rain cloud could have come our way instead of passing by there, or just so many things could go wrong that often don't. And that's great, but it's not always because of our skill level either. It's just sometimes, the way it is.
Yeah. I mean, accidents do happen, and it is a complex place out there.
Yeah.
And kind of like what you say, you know, it was in our minds a safe place to be, or in our, with the knowledge we had or the information we had, it was a safe place to be. But again, that knowledge and that information has holes in it. It's going to be, you know, there's so many layers to it. Mm-hmm. It's really difficult to make
perfect
100% sure decisions.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this group is called the Musk Ox.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's called the Mountain Musk Ox.
Mountain Musk Ox.
Doesn't actually exist in real life.
Right. I knew that. I was like,
What the Musk Ox, what Musk Ox actually do is they kind of like form a bit of a barrier, a shield in front of their young or their wounded or they're weak to protect them from, and I'm not saying that we need protection, but it's more just like when you've experienced trauma or grief in the mountains, you do need to be looked after. You do need to be kind of held close still by your community instead of like, what's the learning here? What can we get from this that you didn't have beforehand, and that just sort of isolates you. So you really do need to feel still part of the process, the part of that learning process, part of that healing process as a community. So that's kind of where we came to name.
Just because something's gone wrong or something's happened while you were present doesn't make you an expert on like immediately thereafter. You know?
No, well, it feels like you're the farthest thing from an expert, actually. It's like there's this feeling where people feel the right to learn right away from an accident instead of maybe just taking a pause and saying, hey, I'm really sorry that happened to you. And let's give it some time and learn together what we can take from this. That would feel a bit more inclusive, I think. But there does feel like an immediacy after an accident. Well, everyone wants to know how they're going to be safe tomorrow. Like, okay, yeah. Well, what's the learning? Let me know so that I can go out there and not be scared and it won't happen to me and my day's going to be great. But, you know, that kind of doesn't feel quite as inclusive maybe to those who just had the accident, or maybe as caring as it could be. You know, the people who experienced it didn't have that hindsight knowledge. They were just out there doing the best they could do in that moment. And now they're trying to live with it.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's so, it's selfish of the community in a sense to look to it like that. I think there's a level of denial almost that we have to be in a bit sometimes with just how dangerous and risky this stuff can be, because otherwise, like you say, we wouldn't enjoy it at all. And we hear something like an accident happening, we want to know all the facts and the details so that we can go back to our denial state. Well, I would never be in that situation, or that's something I would never do. Okay, well, I'll just never do that, and therefore I'm never going to have an accident happen with me, when it's not quite so, doesn't exist in such a vacuum.
Right. And I know I very likely was that person. Like I was judgmental. I still am. It's something that I'm really trying to change my behavior to, when I see things that I don't understand right away, or I feel I don't like the outcome of, to just try to get the whole picture, or try to recognize that I don't know what happened, or I don't know how that person experienced it. And just come in with a bit more of an open mind and open heart towards situations that I didn't experience myself. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's also what motivates me now to run more of these different courses. Like, there's a world of people out there that have experienced life in a different way than I have. Yeah. And I want to be their ally. I want to be someone who, yeah, I don't know what they've experienced, but I want to walk with them from here on in and not just be an outsider looking and yeah, having an opinion about everything that I don't have, shouldn't have an opinion towards.
Or like rock climbing is going to solve all your problems.
Yeah.
So, well, it's actually going to introduce some nuance as well.
Yeah.
So is there a lot of conversation then, or in the clinics now, around this kind of stuff? Like, or how are you kind of integrating, I guess?
Sorry, what do you mean, like, around?
Well, I mean, in some of these introductory clinics, you know, it's about just getting out there, giving it a go, giving it a try, and the conversations around safety and risk and all that sort of stuff. I mean, it starts to click for most people maybe a year in. They've seen some things happen. I'm speaking more kind of about skiing. I don't know as much about climbing and ice climbing, but I guess I'm asking, how are you kind of blending these two, like, sides of, or two poles of the spectrum, I guess, into how you're teaching now, or how you're coaching now? Or,
well, I'll be honest, I'm not teaching and coaching in as big of environments anymore. I'm keeping it a lot more, trying to take out as much of the uncontrolled variables as I can, because I'm not prepared to have something else happen. I mean, things can still happen in a basic rock climbing top rope scenario. You know, someone can maybe not hold the right rope as tight as they think they are. Someone can still fall a couple meters, or a rock can come down from a sheep crossing above them. These things can happen still out there. And I don't think anything has really changed for me in the way I address that. I've always talked about it a lot, and I bring it up a lot and let people know that to really just, everyone needs to have their eyes and ears open. I guess that's the take home in some ways. Like, everyone needs to feel invested and involved in the day and not just think that one person is going to keep them safe. Because one person can only oversee so much of the environment that we're all in.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's something else that's a bad habit of mine, I think. I only really want to speak for myself, but it's a bad habit of mine is that, I mean, there's so many friends of mine who are guides. And if I'm out in the mountains and there's one present, there could be a group of 20. There could be a group of 10. If there's one guide, I'm like, I'm off the clock.
Right.
You know, like I fully get into that backseat. But it's like, what happens if something happens to them? You know what I mean? Where's my head? Am I paying attention? Am I looking around? Like, am I on alert? You know, because you can't just be chatting and goofing off and expecting that person who has more experience than you is going to get everything, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a good thing to remember for sure.
It's a lot on on people like yourselves' shoulders, really, in those kind of more recreational settings. I mean, I'm not really talking about courses and clinics, but in those more recreational settings, it's a lot of pressure or sort of just assumption to make about a person that's also on their day off. Anyway, I'm just thinking about one specific event or a day right now, but anyway. And you're making a film this year. Mm-hmm. Correct?
We started it 2 winters ago. I wanted to attempt a link up of a few hard roots in the ghost area. I've always thought it would be an interesting thing to try. It kind of culminates all of winter climbing. Like, it's a long kind of hard ice climb, and then there's a long challenging mixed climb, which is like a lot of rock transitioning onto ice, transitioning onto rock, transitioning onto ice. And then there's a really hard, mostly dry tooling overhanging climb. So all three are in this valley. And I think it culminates into
where is this valley?
Ghost? What's called the Wipris. It's in the Ghost near here. It's about a 2-hour drive.
Okay.
So it's about 16 pitches of climbing. Wow. And to get in there, you drive for 2 hours and then you have to ski in for another 2 hours. You have 4 hours of travel just to get there on a winter day that may have 8 hours of light. And so then 8 hours to get out, 4 hours to get out again. So anyway, it was an ambitious goal. But I wanted to see if I could to do it, because I hadn't really been climbing since I lost my friend, and I wanted to see if I could still find the joy in the mountains and find the motivation, and also to kind of reinforce the idea of how important community is and asking for help, because I couldn't do this link up alone. I needed my friends to come help me and jug up behind. And so, yeah, that's kind of how the film started. And the main message really is that, you know, grief and trauma is a shared human experience that everyone, unfortunately, will live through at some point in their life. And trying to build more of a language around it and more of an ability to talk about these highs and lows that we experience in the mountains. And just be there for each other, make and normalize it. Because I definitely hit rock bottom, and it wasn't always a sure thing that I was going to stick around, let alone go back into the mountains. So I just felt like it was a message that maybe other people could resonate with.
Oh, for sure. Absolutely. Are you able to find it again? Like, are you finding that joy coming back?
Yeah. Yeah. I definitely have it again. And mountains are like, the mountains will never be the mountains, that day, a climb, nothing is worth like that day to me, obviously. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Nothing's worth that. But I can't take that back. I can't change that. And I know how much the mountains give my life. And I can only move forward with that. And just, yeah, I don't think not going into the mountains will make me a better person, mm-hmm. or make my life more meaningful. I think going back out there and sharing it with other people still, and taking the learnings that I've taken with me, is probably the best thing I can do. And yeah, so it is nice to find joy in the mountains again. And I definitely still love climbing and sharing it with other people.
That's, yeah, I'm happy for you that you're finding it. I can't imagine how convoluted of a process that must be. I'm glad that you have support and that you're creating more support. You know, that's, it seems to me what you do. You see something that's working for you and you multiply it for others. That's really powerful. So hats off to you in that sense.
Thank you.
When is the film coming out?
Maybe for the Squamish Festival.
Oh, for the Academy?
Yeah.
Oh, like this August.
Yeah, maybe.
Wow. That's the hope. Are you working with, and who's your production team?
Heather Mosher.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know the name. I don't know her personally.
Yeah.
She's editing it right now then, I guess, as we speak.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Have you seen a first look?
Yeah, no, I've seen the first look, and we're making a few changes, and yeah, it's hard for me to watch because it's pretty emotional for me. Mm. But I think that's okay. I'm okay with sharing that part of me with everyone, and I hope people can relate and accept me in it.
Of course they will. Oh my gosh, I think if anything, this. We've been starved of vulnerability and starved of honesty in this world of mountain sports and, you know, being out in the mountains. I think it's like, I think people will be all in for stuff like this, and it's going to connect with everyone. Like, as you say, everyone has a story. It's not everyone's is the same necessarily, but everyone knows grief. Everyone knows trauma,
yeah.
In their own way. So I think that's, I'm so looking forward to seeing it. I mean, maybe I shouldn't say this on the podcast, but I'm tentatively invited to the Academy. Yay. So I will tentatively be there, scheduling permitting, but
we'll have to go mountain biking.
Yes. I was gonna say we could go climbing. I've only ever been climbing once. Be very curious. Climbers, I'm blown away by all the time. I'm like, how you manage the fear alone, like, how do you do it? How do you do it?
It's like anything else. The more you do it, the less fear you have. But sometimes you have a ton of fear still. So, and that's right. What we do.
What is the scariest moment you've had? Like, just like, on an ice wall? I'm like, how?
Honestly, like, and photos would help describe this, but I was climbing in Japan with Will, and we approached this ice climb that looked really crazy, just big. Daggery things, and I'm belaying him, and he starts up it when the whole thing settles. So it's like whoomph of all like a huge mass of ice, and in that settlement a big dagger breaks and comes straight for me and landed like literally right in front of me. John Price was taking photos at the time, and he has this series of shots where I'm standing there belaying, and then all of a sudden you don't see me. I'm in this cloud of snow with this dagger there going downhill with it. Luckily it missed me, but I still held my hand on the brake, and I pulled on Will, who's holding onto his ice tools on this piece of ice, getting like yanked like a puppet because on this ice thing pulling me down. Anyway, the whole thing was quite
scary. So you were actually on the ice when
I was on the ground. He was on the ice. I was belaying him leading.
Okay.
The dagger fell almost on me and pushed me down the slope, almost buried me with under this, you know, I don't know, 10 ton dagger. Meanwhile, I'm still pulling on the rope on Will.
Could have gotcha. Okay.
So anyway, that was pretty scary.
Oh my God.
I'll have to send you photos sometimes.
Yes, please do. Oh my gosh. Maybe we can include them with the podcast somehow. Yeah, like link to them in the bottom.
Yeah, that would be good.
So you guys just like pause, like look at each other like, oh, are we all here? Like everyone like say hi if you're here, you know, kind of a moment. Or
and then we're like, okay, let's go home now.
Yeah.
We've had enough of this.
I just learned about the ice wall whoop. Thing factor spring because a friend of mine was telling me about an experience she had with it.
Okay.
That sounds like the scariest thing ever. Like the whole wall you're on just goes
yeah.
And it like shifts a little.
Yeah, big settlement is scary. Ice climbing for sure. Yeah.
Oh my God. So did you started rock climbing and then moved into ice?
Yeah. Yeah.
And how did that happen? It was just kind of like you live in Canmore. It's necessary.
Pretty much.
You had to figure it out.
Exactly. I'm like, okay, there's 8 months of winter here. And so as a climber, I'm going to have to try this ice climbing thing. And so I did. And at first I didn't like it. It's nothing like rock climbing. But then the more I realized how much there is to learn and how much judgment and experience is required to do it, you know, as safely as possible, then that became really quite interesting.
Yeah, no kidding. It's like tools and weather and temperature and...
We should do a whole YouTube series on new ice climbing winter.
Oh my God. There is nothing people like to see more than me suffering. I don't understand. I'm like, when is someone be like, Katie, let's make a YouTube series about you sitting on the beach? Like, that's something you can actually do. Like, if you want to teach me how to ice climb,
yeah, I do.
I would absolutely love to do that.
Okay.
Pending, we're only going like,
yes,
15 feet high. Like I think I'd be an ice boulderer if that's an option. Like
definitely
I just
not an option. Definitely a really bad idea with crampons on. So no, we won't do that.
I just like the heights factor is just crazy to me. Like because so you're on a rope, but you also have the picks, the ice axes. See, I'd be such a noob already. I don't even want to start talking about it.
Start a video right now.
Yeah. I don't even want to start. I'm just going to sound like such an idiot. But what's new, really? So, cool. Well, let's put that on our bucket list for this winter then, Sarah. I would absolutely love to do that with you. I feel like I was at the very least in incredibly good hands.
Thank you.
Well, I'm really excited to see this film. Hoping it premieres at the Academy. That would be incredible. Are there any parting pieces of wisdom, anecdotal stories you'd like to share with the audience prior to connecting with them in Squamish this August?
Mm. No, I just hope everyone watches the Olympics and cheers really hard for Alana. I'm beyond stoked for that. And I think that's one of my highlights of the summer is going to be to watch her be the first Canadian woman in the Olympics for climbing. So go Alana.
So exciting. Go Alana for sure. Oh my gosh. Yeah. That's going to be awesome.
Go Sean as well. But I just want to give a plug for Alana.
Yeah. No, it's really neat. I'm really excited to watch the climbing this year. Period.
Yeah.
So awesome. Well, thanks so much, Sarah.
Thank you.
It's been great chatting.
Keep putting up the videos. We love
them. I'll do my best. Okay. That's awesome.
That was Sarah Hueniken, who you can find at Hunes, H-U-E-N-S, on Instagram. Connect with Sarah to talk climbing, clinics, accessibility, and or discover a community for processing grief and trauma. Acknowledging her bravery for not only what she accomplishes in the mountains physically, but the vulnerability required to lead conversations and movements that shine light on the more difficult elements of this lifestyle. Thank you. This has been The Arc of It with Katie Burrell.